That's awesome. Two portions this morning. First is in Isaiah chapter 28, and we spoke a little bit about this morning at the 9 o'clock service, but this is an amazing thought, and it goes so well with what we just heard and the song. Isaiah 28, verse 20. For the bed is shorter than a man can stretch himself on it, and the covering narrower than he can wrap himself in it. Has anyone ever lived in a bed that's shorter than your feet? Your feet stick out. Or the blanket is not long enough, and it's cold, and you're trying to wrap it on you, and you're coming up short. But this is what verse 21 says. For the Lord shall rise up as in Mount Perazim. He shall be wroth as in the valley of Gibeon, that he may do his work, his strange work, and bring to pass his act, his strange act. Now, what is the strange work and the strange act? It's found in Ezekiel chapter 36. And we just heard from our pastor. This is amazing. God's strange work. God's strange act. Ezekiel 36, verse 26. A new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you. I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and you shall keep my judgments and do them. Let's pray. Father, thank you. As we heard, our heart is like your heart because you have given us a new heart, a new spirit. You have taken out the old heart. You have done what no one could do. You have redeemed us and called us your own. Bless this portion for your glory in Christ's name. Amen. And this morning, I just want us to think about a covering. And we're going to just look at three portions. And the first is Abraham, Genesis 15. And we know the life of Abraham. God calls him in Genesis chapter 12. But then there's a period of time where God and Abraham aren't communicating. And as a result, during that period of time, Abraham does things in his own strength, covers himself, makes his own decisions. And as a result, there is death. There's a work of the flesh. And in Genesis 15, God calls unto him and says, Abraham, I am the Lord God. Walk before me and be perfect. And he can say, God, whoa, do you remember the last three chapters? I mean, we know the Bible, there's not chapters. But he could say in his heart, Lord, you did speak to me, but things didn't work out the way I thought. But we love this verse in Genesis 15, verse 6. And Abraham believed God, and it was imputed to him for righteousness. We just heard the verse from our pastor. I have found David, the son of Jesse, a man after mine own heart, who shall fulfill all my will, because he received the righteousness of God as his covering. And that's amazing. We are not righteous in ourselves. We fall so short of the righteousness of God in our own strength. But that's not what it's about. That's not the end of the day. Maybe it's the beginning. You're struggling. Maybe you even came in here and you're a little bit like, I'm just here. I'm just here. And we hear the song, we say, Lord, I'm just waiting for the day to be over. But God gives us a promise. And the second person I want us to think about this morning is Moses. Exodus chapter 3. Moses, he knew he was the promise. He was the one who would deliver Israel. But he acted in his own righteousness. And what did he do? He killed a man. And he buried him in the sand. And he departs from God. And there's 40 years that pass. 40 years of hearing, you did it in your own strength. 40 years. You know the accusations of the flesh that accuse you? And then you know what? God shows up at the burning bush. And it's not consumed. And God says, Moses, Moses. And Moses is like, here am I. He says, take off your shoes, for the place where you stand on is holy ground. And he begins to explain to Moses his plan. And Moses is great with it until God says, you go to Pharaoh. And he's like, whoa, 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 time out, God. The plan was okay until that part. He says, do you know who I am? And God says, I am that I am is sending you. It's my righteousness, Moses. That's your covering. My ability, not your ability. My character and nature, not your character and nature. And then the last person I want us to think about this morning is in Philippians chapter 3, the Apostle Paul. And he talks about his history. And he says, I was circumcised the 8th day, beginning at verse 8. And he goes through, and I am a Pharisee of Pharisees. And then he says this amazing thing, but the things that were gain unto me, I counted them but loss. I do not go about to establish my righteousness based upon my genetical background or what I've done in my own ability or strength. I count them but loss for the excellency of Christ. And that's why we say, God says, I will do a work. I will do a work, and it's going to be a marvelous work. What is the work? It is in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 18 through 25. It is the cross. It is the power of God. It is the weak things. It is the base things. It's the things that are despised, the things that are lost. But God glories in the cross. That's how he gives us a new heart and a new spirit. And we say by the grace of God in Galatians 2:20, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ lives in me. And the life that I now live, it's no longer that my past. It's no longer my failures. It's no longer my insecurities. It's no longer even my abilities. I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. And in verse 21, I do not frustrate the grace of God. The grace of God is, it's the righteousness of God. We are saved by grace and not of ourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Amen? Let's pray. Father, thank you so much this morning that at the end of the day, you have given us your heart. We are not our own. We have been bought with a price. Therefore, we glorify you in our mortal bodies. Father, just bless the remainder service. Thank you. Thank you that we don't have to establish our own righteousness any longer. For it's filthy rags in your sight. But we are clothed with the righteousness of Christ. It's by grace. It's a finished work. It's eternal. And you get the glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Okay, would you stand with me, please, and turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 3. And I'll ask Pastor Steve to bring the chairs out. We have chairs. We can watch Pastor Steve here for a second stumble out with the chairs. Okay, this is a, these are props for the message that some of you are familiar with. What are these two chairs over here? The tree of knowledge of good and evil, right? That's these chairs. Let's put them in a way where they look more comfortable, like they're having a little coffee talk, coffee chat in the garden. There we go. Good and evil, tree of good and evil. And this one? Tree of life. Where do we read about these trees? In Genesis, in the Garden of Eden. We could even put them closer. Let's put them this way. Tree of life, tree of the knowledge of good and evil. What tree you should not eat of? The knowledge, tree of knowledge of good and evil. Why do you know that? Because you read it in the Bible. Is that where you found it out? Okay, where do we not eat? Tree of knowledge of good and evil. Okay, knowledge. How many want knowledge? What kind? Knowledge of good and evil or life, yeah, life, tree of life, okay. Pastor Davis just spoke about God covering us, and that is a good kind. When Adam and Eve were in the Garden of Eden, they were covered by God's presence. We could say they were covered by the glory of God, the knowledge of God, the wisdom of God, the presence of God. Christ was in the Garden of Eden with Adam and Eve, and they had a covering. But when they sinned and they ate of this tree, what happened? When they ate of the tree of knowledge of good and evil, what happened to them? What? They lost the covering, okay? They were naked, they knew it. Before they were naked, but not really. They were covered by God and His presence, but now they feel ashamed. Have you ever been in a shower, public shower room, and felt ashamed? Yeah, let's not talk about it in church. What else would happen to them? They felt ashamed or embarrassed. And what is the other word? Guilt. Yeah, they were guilty. What's the third word? They were afraid. How do we know they were afraid? They hid themselves. Wow, you guys are right on it. They are really in trouble. The day you eat thereof, you shall surely die. How do you, there's three parts to man: physical, soulish, and spiritual. When the day they ate of the tree, they died. But did they die physically? They lived physically. But in a way, they did. Death started to work in their mortal body. Death started on that day. It was like a gnawing worm, a disease, some change in the body happened on that day, but it took more than 900 years before their physical body died. But spiritually, they died immediately, and in their soul, this fear, shame, and guilt was an evidence of their soul dying. They are suffering people. Okay? And there was now a covering of a curse. Oops. There's a covering or a veil. And now they are cursed. because of sin. That happens, has happened in every one of our lives, and I want to bring you the good news this morning. Pastor Schaller, we heard enough about the bad news. Could you lighten it up and give us a good message? Amen? All right, you may be seated. Here's a good question for you theologians today. When Jesus came and he was a man, who he was God and he was man, correct? 100% God, 100% man. Did he ever eat of that tree? He never ate of that tree. And the tree of life was really where he lived, where he ate. But we understand that the eating of the tree isn't just simply referring to physical food, as in the Garden of Eden, because the Garden of Eden is really gone. Has anybody seen it? Isn't it in a hotel down in Miami called the Garden of Eden? Wasn't there a European explorer who went to find the fountain, was it? Fountain of Youth in St. Augustine, Florida? Remember? Who knows the name of Ponce de Leon? Okay, thank you. Was that it? Okay. But we have not found the Garden of Eden on this earth, or the Fountain of Youth, or eternal life. Anywhere. I've noticed on cable TV they're selling a lot of vitamins, a lot of exercise equipment, a lot of health creams, and all kinds of creams and stuff to try to keep and maintain our health, our youth. And another thing here at this tree, there are three words you can remember about the temptation, and it was: the tree was beautiful. And this is the way we are made. We are attracted to beautiful things. Beauty, we can recognize it. Whatever you describe it, I don't know. They describe beauty different ways. Harmony, there are contrasts, and they can read about it if you want, what is beautiful and so on. It's beautiful tree. Number two, it's knowledge. That's another thing I am drawn to. I'm drawn to what is beautiful. I'm drawn to knowledge. And the third thing is food. I think many of you can identify with the last part of the temptation. Food. Our stomach. Our physical body, our sensuality, how many men are drawn to women, how many women are drawn to men, how many people are drawn to knowledge, how many people are drawn to the table of food, how much of this is a part of our life. And also, there's a veil. We can say that there is a veil even over our face, a veil that is over our Bible. And when we read the Bible, we can't really see what is in the Bible. There is a veil over Jesus. When I see Jesus, I just see a man, maybe a wayward rabbi, a kind of a teacher who's gone off the rails. There's a veil that is even over my perception of the church, my perception of people, my perception of myself. Oh, shucks, I'm not much. Oh, golly, gee whiz. You know, I'm not much. There is a low value and with people a high value of themselves, because there is a veil and they can't really see. This veil is used in this chapter, 2 Corinthians chapter 3, for a historical event that took place with Moses. In the story in the book of Exodus, the Jews are having a party with idolatry at the very center of the party. They made a golden calf and said that this is the God that brought them out of Egypt. And Moses is up on the mountain receiving the law. And when he comes down, there's a disconnect that they are partying, but he has been with God and has seen the glory of God so much that his face is shining like he is on fire. He is understanding. He has been with Christ. So we will start reading from verse 12 of this chapter. Would you read it out loud with me? Verse 12. Seeing then that we have such hope, we use great plainness of speech. Isn't that great to go to to be with brothers and sisters where there is plainness of speech? Even I understood what he was saying. Isn't that a great meeting to go to? Well, I understand. Even now I am starting to understand my Bible. Even now I am starting to understand what it means to be a believer. And we use great plainness of speech in our faith. Tonight, I want to speak a very interesting message about the tongue. And I have a lot of experience with believers and unbelievers using the tongue and my own self. And I want to speak about being in the world and the tongue of the believer. So that'll be a joy tonight. Pray for that. Verse 13. And not as Moses, which put a veil over his face, that the children of Israel could not steadfastly look to the end of that which is abolished. I'm going to have to take that verse apart, because I know I've lost half of you. So we got time. We got a couple hours. No, we got time. Okay, listen. Moses has been with God, and it is so clear that it has affected his body, that he has God's presence and his glory on him, and when he comes, there are times in the record where you see he walks amongst the Jewish people and he has a veil over his face. And that's what this is referring to, that there is a veil. In other words, the veil is really representing the division between God and sinful people, between us. The veil has to do with our sin, the separation between us and God. And God is there, but I can't see it. Christ is here, but I don't see the glory of God. The Bible is here, but I can't really read it. That somehow when I read it, I don't understand it. Read this with me. Verse 13. Moses put a veil over his face so that the children of Israel could not look to the end of that which is abolished. What was abolished was the law. Yeah, this is in the context. The first covenant, the Ten Commandments, could not... The Ten Commandments given to people that are sinners, all that it does for these people, and when you give them the Ten Commandments, they say, you shall not commit adultery. They sit in the tree, in the chair of good. You shall not commit adultery. And then I say, but on a certain set of circumstances, and like what it goes on in my heart, I do commit adultery. But you should not commit adultery. I know. Why do I feel like doing it? Why do I want to break the law? Why? Because I'm a sinner. Thou shalt not lie. I know I will never lie. I'll never lie. 2.5 years later, there's just an opportunity. I lie. Right? And there's a veil. And when I read the scripture, I'm not so interested. And when I look at Jesus, I really can't see him. Why is that? What happened? It's called sin. It's my sin nature. I still have it, though I am born again. When I am born again, I read in the Bible that I died. That when Christ died, I died also. And I read in the Bible that when Christ was raised from the dead, I was raised from the dead also. And what does that mean? But I am now a partaker with God in Christ. Remember, Christ never ate at that tree. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Come unto me. Learn of me. I am meek and lowly. My way is easy. It is God's way. God is with me. I have the glory of God upon me. Have you seen the glory of God? Read it with me. Verse 14. But their minds were blinded. Whose minds? I thought I lost half of you. Now I know I lost two-thirds of you. You're drifting off, you know, you're all over the place. Look at verse 14. But their minds were blinded, for until this day remaineth the same veil untaken away in the reading of the Old Testament. Wait a minute. You mean when the Jewish people read the Old Testament, there's a veil? And they can't see Christ in the Old Testament as we see. But wait a minute. Don't Gentiles have the same problem? That when Gentiles read the Bible, they cannot see that this is Christ? Remember the disciples on the road to Emmaus? And their eyes were blinded and they could not see. And Christ opened the scripture and showed them, and it was like this experience. They heard him speak about himself. And it said their hearts did burn within them. And they realized, and then it says Christ broke the bread, and then he disappeared. And they were amazed. They had just seen him because the veil was taken away. When Jesus died on that cross, not that cross, but the cross, definitely wasn't that one all lit up. When he died on the cross, when Christ died on the cross, it was the judgment of God upon this sinful man, on that nature. And when Christ was raised from the dead, then man was brought into the kingdom, translated from darkness into light. And now we are partakers of that light. Verse 15. But even unto this day, when Moses is read, the veil is upon their heart. Remember the veil in the Old Testament tabernacle and Solomon's temple and Herod's temple in the time of Christ? When Christ was crucified, what happened to the veil inside the temple that separated us from God? It was rent from the top down to the bottom. And Josephus, the Jewish historian, said that that veil was so thick it was the width of a man's hand, and it was lifted up by some teams of oxen. It was so heavy. That oxen pulled that by some engineering of lifting the veil and fastening it permanently. Big, thick, heavy veil ripped on the very time of the crucifixion from the top to the bottom, making a way for a sinful man to enter into the Holy of Holies, into God's very presence and see his glory. It's written right there. Follow it with me if you're not asleep. And even if you are, follow it with me. Look at verse 15. Even on this day when Moses read, the veil is upon their heart. Nevertheless, when it shall turn to the Lord, the veil shall be taken away. Nevertheless, when you turn to the Lord, when we say, I am tired of my sin, I'm tired of the veil, I'm tired of not understanding what is the meaning of life. This is the problem over here. We don't understand. Like, does it really mean much that I make a paycheck and work hard and eat okay, eat maybe very well, and I have my toys and my things that I do, and I read my books and I live my life and I have my family? But behind it is a big question. Is there more? Tell me, is there more? Is there something I do not see? Is there more? Is there God? Is there peace like a river? Oceans of righteousness lapping up on the shore, wave after wave? Is there deep satisfaction? Is there, in a word, glory? The glory of God. Not my glory, like I got a fifth place on a swimming match, which I did once. I got fifth place. I don't even know what color that ribbon was. You know, like dirty yellow or something. I don't know. It was, I like fit. There's only six lanes in the pool, and I came in fifth. I had my glory. You know, I got a watch after I worked for the company for 50 years. I had my glory. My name was in the paper. Mom, it is in the paper. Look again. Look again. Mom, my name is there in the paper. Look again. Or the graffiti on the highway up high in the rocks. Debbie loves Steve. That's all I got my whole life. That's the best I could get. Is that what you have? Yes, the prophet said, our glory is our shame. It is nothing, a pile of dust, of a name in a paper, the paper is gone, the name has disappeared. Have you ever walked through the cemetery and realized in this cemetery, no one that is alive knows anything about anyone in this cemetery? No one knows, because the cemetery is from the 1600s, 1700s. No one knows anyone buried here. Their only hope is that their life meant something because God knows their name. There. That's the only hope, that this life is not sin, but it is God's grace, God's mind, God's heart. At the end of the day, my heart is like your heart. Wow. Let's close by reading 17 and 18. Now the Lord is that Spirit. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is, what's the word? Liberty. Liberty. Big word. Liberty. Liberty. Yeah, I can do whatever I want. Okay, that's fine. You can do whatever you want, but what is it? What does it mean? How long is the leash? Where's the boing, the plexiglass of the aquarium? You are a fish in an aquarium, a dog on a leash. I can do anything I want. Well, Jesus said, if you sin, you are in bondage. You are the servant of sin. But Christ said, come unto me, learn of me. I am the way, the truth, and the life. And when you know the truth, it will set you free. Real freedom. I mean, you're not even afraid of death. Oh, death, where is your sting? Oh, grave, where is your victory? You're not even afraid of sin. You say, sin, I don't care about you. I found another way. I found the tree of life. I found Christ is the answer for me. I found real liberty. I found the Spirit of glory. I found the face of Christ. Look at verse 18. But we all, with open face. Face. Big word. Another big word. Kind of do one of these to you. Boy, real hard. Some of you deserve it. No, I'm joking. No, wham! My face. Have you ever seen something more beautiful than a human face? How about a baby's face? How about a face of somebody you love? I'll meet you at the airport. When you meet them, they're there at the airport. That face means a lot. And I love that whole idea of seeing a face, what it does in an old elderly person's life. When they see somebody they know, they recognize, somebody they love, the face, what it means, it's so amazing. I read about in our Civil War soldiers, photography was a new science during the time when the Civil War, just those years, photography was finding its place, and it was a new thing. But many soldiers on the battlefield, they found their dead bodies holding a photo. You know, when they were shot and dying on the field, they pull it out. That was it. That's what they had. That was their comfort. That was all they had in life. That was it. Yes. You know, when we sin, we lose the face of God. There's a veil. And it's like, I can only see me. I can't really see even myself very well. I am blinded by myself. But when we turn to the Lord, and this is what you have done recently or years ago, and you keep going, you keep that, you say, I believe that the basis of my life is not my sin, but it is God and His grace. And I have another covering, the covering that Adam and Eve had in the beginning in the Garden of Eden, where they were naked, but they weren't. Because this is the covering that God made for man. This is the covering of God Himself, which gives the man his liberty. But notice, what did draw me to the sin? Beauty, knowledge, food, right? What drew me to the tree of knowledge? Beauty, it was beautiful to look at. It would make me wise, and it's good for food. What draws me to the cross? Look at the cross. It actually is ugly. It is not beautiful. It looks foolish to me that Christ would be dying on a cross, and where are His words of wisdom? Where is His authority over death? I cannot see it. It looks like it's foolish. And there is no food there. There's nothing there for me, many people say. But this is the curveball God has thrown the human race. It looks like the ball's coming straight and it curves. It looks like I don't understand it, because God says you must come to me by faith. Follow me. I will show you liberty and my face. Verse 18, we all with open face beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. Hey, have you gone back to your high school lately? Gone back to the high school guys, high school gals, had any talk with them and realized they haven't changed? They've changed in maybe a bad way. But have you ever been with them and just say the same old, remember that pass in the last game of our high school, remember homecoming queen? Hey, do you remember this old chemistry teacher? Remember? And it's like, yeah, that's fine. Is there anything else going on in your life? Is there anything moving, anything going on deep in your heart? Have you found Christ? Have you seen the glory of God? Have you found liberty? Have you found peace? Have you found righteousness? Do you have hope? A living hope have you found? Have you seen the face of Christ, and have you been changed from glory to glory, even by the Spirit of the Lord? And I say this not to demean people, because I know what that is, but glory be to God, I know what that is too. I know what that is, and I have sympathy. I met two high school buddies. I hadn't seen them for 42 years or something, and we sat and had a talk. And I appreciated it and loved them, and I'm not any different. But also, by God's grace, we have come to Christ, and the veil is taken away. And that cross, to the world, there's nothing there but to us. Not that physical thing on the wall, but death to self by faith in God. And He gives us His Spirit, His mind, His purpose. And we say, hallelujah, my life is more than strawberry shortcake. My life is more than a diploma, a ribbon, a bank account, a good name, or whatever it might be, my life is, as in the song, that my heart might be like your heart. That's amazing. Oh, I almost fell down right here. My heart, imagine, that's what we have. And we say it in brokenness, humility, and amazement that Jesus came not to be a God 2,000 years ago that he was on a cross and is not there anymore, but to be the God that says, I am with you, lo, I am with you even unto the end of the age. I am your satisfaction, I am your peace, I am your love, I am your joy, I am your wisdom, I am your future, I am your life, I have overcome. And you might be hurting and you might be in trouble today, but you got an answer that nobody could ever give you except God himself. You have a living Christ, a living God, and it says by his face, with open face. It used to be covered, but now it is like open face. Like just a face within. I'll share a short story. Okay. Pastor Matti. How many remembers the story? You remember hearing the story, anybody? Pastor Matti. Does that trigger anything? Joke. Story number 42. Does that trigger? Oh, I know that joke. Okay, so we tell stories over and over so often. We got them all numbered, so I don't have to tell them, but I only give the number. Okay. He tells this story. He's from Eastern Finland. Maybe he's listening now. He's a missionary in Oman. But he tells a story that when he was a little boy in his home, he had taken some cookies out of a cookie jar. And his mother said, did you take the cookies? He said, no, I didn't. She said, are you sure you didn't take the cookies? Like, who else could do it? Because you're the only child in this house. Okay, did you take them? No, I didn't. And she said, I want you to take your finger, and I want you to go around like this, and I'm going to talk to you. So he's like, cocks his head and wonders, what's going on? Okay. So he takes his finger, and he goes like this. And she said, did you take the cookies? And he goes, yes, I do. Okay, you figure that out psychologically, okay? I can't do that. I'm not going to get it. Okay, you figure out what it had to do with that, you know, the finger, okay? And then take it home and use it. You know what I think about that story? I think that there's something about us that if you talk straight to this person that has these problems and this kind of blindness and this veil that's disturbing them, and you just say, you know I'm telling you the truth, and that God bears witness to the human heart, and say, you know that it isn't as great as you say it is. You know that your sinful life isn't a great blessing like you say it is. You know that you have taken the cookies. You know that. You know that you got a problem that's going on deep in your heart and you have no control over it. You know this. But we are here to say hallelujah, glory be to God. This answer is not from us. It's from God. That God gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. And more so even, that man who now has Christ would have a new life, a new birth, a new way, a new name, a new relationship with God himself looking face to face. And by the way, God is excited about you. He is. When Justin, my son, was born 32 years ago, I was in the hospital up in Massachusetts holding him and looking at him, counting his digits, pushing him, poking him, holding him. And when I looked at that little baby boy, what do you think I thought? How is he going to be? What is his personality going to be like? Is he going to be okay? Is he going to make it? Is he going to survive? Is he going to be, how old will he be one day? What is he going to do? What is his future? Every parent has it built in them, that kind of love and relationship for their child. And beloved, it does not yet appear what we shall be. But we know that when we see him, we shall be like him. And that God, our Heavenly Father, did not make us to destroy us or shame us or put us in fear and guilt. He made us to be like him. My heart, at the end of the day, that my heart would be like your heart. And that gives him great pleasure, and it's been made possible by his great sacrifice, his great love, and his great wisdom. Amen. Would you pray with me? If you're here today and you don't have Jesus in your life, this is an invitation from God. Not from me, though he uses us, but it's from God in the Word. To as many as received him, to them he gave the legal power to become the children of God. Born not of the will of man, nor the will of flesh, nor of blood, but born of God. You are born of God by believing in Christ. Do it today. Say, I believe in Christ. I want Christ in my life. And then raise your hand if you're saying that prayer this morning. Anyone at all? Check the hallway, too. There's some folks out there. Anyone at all? Right here in the room? Anyone at all? Yes to Jesus. We'll give you a booklet and pray for you. Love you. God bless you. Anyone at all? Yes to Jesus. Oh, we need Jesus. And then to grow in him. What a blessing. What a blessing to grow in him. Thank you, Lord. In Christ's name, amen.